Deep below the dense tropical rainforests of South America, there is a dark and hidden landscape. A place so vast and dangerous that only the bravest explorers enter. With 17 species of the most poisonous snakes in the world, jaguars that stalk in the shadows and piranha lurking in the water, the Amazon has a fearsome reputation. Conditions are so extreme that many explorers who have entered have never been heard from again. But that hasn't stopped more people from coming. Since the arrival of the conquistadors in the 16th century, tales of wondrous cities of extreme wealth and size have captivated explorers, drawing more victims to the ever-present dangers of the Amazon. The legendary El Dorado, the city of gold, has inspired many maps, myths, and doomed expeditions. A tantalizing reward that's always just beyond the next river bend. For years, explorers have gone in search of these famed cities. In 1924, Percy Fawcett, a British geographer, set off to the Amazon in the hunt for a lost city he called Z. In 1925, Percy's last message to the outside world was to his wife in a letter he wrote, "You need have no fear of any failure." He was never seen again. But was his search in vain? For years, scientists have been saying that it would be impossible for a large population to have survived within the Amazon due to the infertile land that would not sustain farming. But much of what we thought we knew about this secretive place has since been confounded. New data brought to light uncovers some of its deepest mysteries. I'm Jordan Ferguson, and you're watching See It First. Join me in this video as we take a journey into the depths of the Amazon and uncover its secrets. Our journey begins 479 years ago, when Francisco de Orellana set out from Quito, chasing the riches of El Dorado. Ahead of him lies a basin of more than 6 million square kilometers of rainforest, nearly twice the size of India and spanning 9 countries. Rivers here don't behave like rivers elsewhere. This network carries about a fifth of the planet's freshwater runoff, and its floodplains change rapidly with the seasons. Within weeks, his men are paying the price. Heat, humidity, insects, and disease. Within months, most of his men were gone. Claimed by a forest that holds a third of the world's animal biodiversity. Stranded and low on supplies, Orellana continued down the Rio Napo, hoping the river would carry them out. But it only carried them deeper. They burn and pillage indigenous settlements as they find them, but news outruns the boats. Soon enough, arrows bombard them from the trees. Man after man falls and becomes food for the piranha. Time stretched on. The jungle took its share. Parasites and piranha, mold and malaria, arrows flying from the dark, and the night sounds of insects and snakes keeping them up at night. Until finally, the boat nosed into the Atlantic. A hunt for a city of gold had quickly become a fight to stay alive. For centuries, explorers like Orellana and Fawcett chased golden cities and hidden kingdoms. Then came the modern era, when scientists set those stories aside. In the 1940s, two young archaeologists, Betty Meggers and Clifford Evans, went to the Amazon to make sense of its past. What they found seemed to confirm a hard lesson. Soils were thin, nutrients leached fast, and fields gave up their strength in just a few seasons. In 1971, Meggers gathered this into a single phrase that would define a generation of thinking: a counterfeit paradise. Because even though the rainforest looked lush and fertile, it set strict limits. Too poor to sustain big surpluses, too restless to anchor cities. Monumental stone was missing, rivers wandered, making roads and walls seem futile. So the map was drawn as small villages strung along channels. Anything more was impossible. For decades, this view sat in textbooks and museum labels. It became the baseline against which every new claim had to struggle. Not everyone agreed. In 1970, Donald Lathrop argued that the Upper Amazon held deeper histories of complexity than the prevailing model allowed. Dense pottery traditions, river networks, and long cultural continuities that didn't fit the simple limits story. The debate grew pointed, but the counterfeit paradise frame remained dominant. If the land caps crops, it also caps cities. By the early 1990s, a few scholars began to pry at the edges of that certainty. Geographer William Denevan wrote about the Pristine myth, the idea that the Americas were empty wilderness in 1492, and assembled evidence that the people had reshaped vast landscapes long before Europeans arrived. He didn't rewrite history overnight, but he changed the question. Not could people thrive here, but what more would we notice if we knew where to look? For most of the 20th century, the consensus held. Big cities and lasting complexity could not exist under this canopy. And yet, new eyes and new methods were arriving. The next part of our journey begins when the vast canopy stopped being a barrier, and the ground started to tell a different story. Local farmers had long known of patches of unusually fertile black earth that just didn't exhaust. 19th century naturalists noted them, but assumed a natural origin. Mid-20th century excavations showed something a bit more interesting. They contained charcoal, pottery, fishbone, and organic waste. These were human-made soils known as Terra Preta, carbon-rich soil that retains nutrients and remains productive for centuries. In a region where typical rainforest soil loses fertility quickly, Terra Preta supports sustained farming, gardens, orchards, and fields in the same place over long periods of time. But the biggest surprise came when archaeologists began flying laser scanners over the canopy. Pulses pass through gaps in the leaves and return a bare earth model. When they stripped away vegetation in the software, incredible patterns appeared. Straight causeways, rectangular platforms, ring ditches and canals. Put it together and this combination overturns the old assumptions. It shows that people didn't just survive in the Amazon, they planned landscapes and engineered soils to make long-term life possible. Next, we'll look at specific regions where these patterns are clearest and what they can tell us about how these societies were organized. One of the clearest examples comes from the Upano Valley. Lidar surveys and excavations have revealed a network of rectangular streets, thousands of earthen platforms, and open plazas. Archaeologists count more than 6,000 platforms spread across the valley. These weren't built in stone, but in earth, arranged in a way some call garden urbanism. Towns interwoven with fields, terraces, and drainage canals. People here lived in organized settlements that worked with the landscape, rather than clearing it away. In western Brazil, deforestation revealed another layer of history, the Acre geoglyphs. Over 450 geometric earthworks, circles, squares, and straight ditches stretch across 13,000 square kilometers. Their exact purpose is debated: ceremonial sites, gathering places, or boundary markers. But they show a clear tradition of large-scale landscape engineering carried out for centuries. All of these societies shared strategies that made Amazonian life sustainable. Raised fields lifted crops above floodwater. Canals and fish weirs turned seasonal floods into a source of food. Orchards and managed forests provided reliable harvests of fruit and nuts. And on fertile Terra Preta, crops could grow year after year without exhausting the soil. These discoveries changed the way we see the Amazon. People here did not conquer the rainforest in the way outsiders once imagined. They adapted to it. For centuries, the Amazon was described as an untouched wilderness. Vast, empty, and resisting permanent human presence. The new evidence changes that picture completely. What LIDAR and soil studies reveal is a cultural landscape, a place shaped and managed by people for thousands of years. Roads, canals, platforms, orchards, and engineered soils weren't accidents of nature, they were deliberate design choices. It shows remarkable resilience and ingenuity. Instead of forcing the rainforest into submission, these societies adapted to its cycles of flood and drought. They built with earth instead of sown, created fertile soil where none existed, and turned wetlands into sources of food. This also challenges the way we often define urban life. Western models expect cities in stone, densely packed, with clear boundaries. The Amazon shows us another possibility: low-density urbanism, spread out, interwoven with gardens and forest. These were real cities, just built on different principles. We can't ignore how these civilizations ended. The decline doesn't appear to have come from collapse within, but from contact without. When Europeans arrived in the 16th century, they didn't just bring steel and muskets. They carried diseases like smallpox, influenza, and measles. For peoples with no prior exposure, mortality rates may have reached up to 80 to 90%. Entire communities disappeared within a generation, leaving roads to fade, canals to silt up, and orchards to merge back into the forest. This is why, when later explorers pushed inland, they often saw only scattered villages and assumed that was how it had always been. In truth, they were walking through landscapes that had been emptied by epidemics before they ever set foot there. And this is not unique to the Amazon. The story of societies undone by forces beyond their control is a pattern we see across the world. In last week's video, we explored those forces that swallowed cities whole and what forces we may be facing today. Because these discoveries are not just about the past, they matter for the present. Across the Amazon, many of these sites are still under threat. Expanding deforestation and large-scale agribusiness cut into the landscapes faster than archaeologists can record them. Earthworks, canals, and ancient soils risk being erased a second time, and this time, permanently. That's why researchers argue that archaeology can be a tool for conservation. Protecting these sites means protecting the forest around them. Cultural heritage and ecological heritage are bound together. One cannot be saved without the other. It's a reminder that the Amazon is not just a natural wonder, but a human one too. Explorers once searched for gold and found only stories. What we're finding now is far more valuable. the memory of cities hidden in the forest itself. The Amazon still guards its secrets. With every flight of Lidar, with every handful of dark earth sifted through a screen, more of its past comes into focus. Yet for all that has been revealed, we may still have seen only a fraction of what lies beneath the canopy. The lines beneath the leaves show us that the Amazon was never empty. And if cities could vanish here, in a place so vast and alive, we're left with a question. What other histories lie hidden, waiting to be revealed? If you'd like to explore more stories like this, where travel, history, and mystery meet, join us here on See It First. Subscribe and be the first to see the past come back into view.